Okay, so here's the pond. We did not build this pond. We just inherited this pond as a client in our maintenance division. And in the last couple of days, we have seen magnificent increase in water clarity of the pond. But here's where the problem is that almost right away, we started to see fish health problems. And unfortunately, it's hard to pin exactly how this came about. The picture that's in the video here that I'm showing you right now is a picture of the fish that that unfortunately started this whole thing. But a lot of people don't realize how simple it is. The first line of defense in dealing with fish health is salt. Now, in the very beginning of this video here, and I'm going to show you right now, I'm going to show you the right way to go about selecting the salt, what the proper dosage is, what it's going to go after, how it's going to fight, and how salt can do a lot of different really great things for your pond. Like, for example, teach you what the water volume is inside your pond, as well as go after and kill some of the most deadly bacteria, deadly bugs that are going to go after your fish. Right now, I'm going to take a look at these guys, and I'm going to do a preliminary health inspection just to kind of do a little bit of a visual inspection and see what I can see. Okay, so there's going to be two types of salts that you're going to find typically in your home improvement stores. One of them is going to be in a yellow bag generally. This stuff here by Morton says clean and protect. Oftentimes when it says clean and protect, you're going to find that there's ingredients inside there like chlorine and other things that you don't want. So we do not want the yellow bag. We do want this. Another thing I want to point out is the size. These are pretty big chunks of salt right here. And with the pure and natural, this is what you're gonna find inside. And this is gonna dissolve really, really well inside your pond. So this is exactly what we're looking for. This is what we want. Do not get the pond, excuse me, do not get the swimming pool salt. Go into the section of the store that sells water softener salt, and this is what you want. So here's my rub with pool salt. Pool salt is, again, you're gonna find this in your pool section in your hardware store, and it's really great. I mean, if you look at the size of the salt granules, those salt granules are gonna dissolve really well. They're gonna go really fast. But here is where the rub that I have is this. Contains a stain fighter, right? But then when we go over here to the ingredients, it says clearly that the only thing that's inside of is sodium chloride. So what I don't understand is what the stain fighter is. And because of that, I don't trust it. And that's why I've always used the Morton's water softener crystals. Again, it is all natural. And this stuff here, it's the right size grain. This is what I recommend all my customers use, and we've never had a problem with it. This is good stuff. I just can't say I trust this. Not for a pond, maybe for a pool, but not for a pond. So here's 40 pounds of salt in a 5-gallon bucket from, Lowe's. And just putting it inside the pond is pretty simple. All we're gonna do is we're just gonna broadcast it by hand, try to get about of an even application. And that's gonna be the end of today's dose. My maintenance manager, John, he's also my youngest brother. He's gonna be coming back out here, I think on Thursday, to service this pond. And that's where he's going to check this pond with the digital salt meter, check to see where the current salt level is inside the pond, and then determine from that point forward truly exactly how many gallons the pond is and increase the dosage. I'm going to leave a bunch of buckets just like this with lids on them on the back over here where the filter is. And when John comes back later on in the week, he's going to come back and deal with that. My goal here is to get the pond up to 25 pounds of salt per 1,000 gallons of water, or 2.5 pounds per 100 gallons. At a 2.5 ratio, this is going to be at the ideal salinity level for medicinal treatment of the pond against the bacteria that I'm going to discuss with you when I get back to my office. There's no need to worry about the fish. You're just kind of curious. They're saying, hey, what's going on? What are you throwing inside here? And one thing about salt is that once you put it into the pond, once it's in, it's not out until you do water changes. Fortunately for us, in this particular system, water changes are going to be really simple because of the way this pond was designed. But For now, all I want to do is I just want to get this in there and get it dissolved. I'm going to go ahead and broadcast on the other side of the pond here in just a minute. Whew. Wow, that's half the bucket right there. All right, let's go around to the other side. If you've salted your pond with success, and if you are like watching this video and you're going, wow, this is actually really great, I'm so glad that someone else is finally talking about this, please leave a comment down below. And if you have questions about this process, or about this pond, or about the sick fish, again, please be sure to leave your comments down below, because I do answer 100%, every single question left behind on my channel. All right, the other half of the bucket, that's going in right now. That'll constitute 40 pounds into this pond. And then, like I say, when John comes back and he treats or does the maintenance on this pond in a couple of days, he's gonna hit it with the digital salt meter. That's gonna tell him exactly what the current salt level is inside the pond. And by that time, wow, we're gonna know a lot of different things, exactly how many gallons this pond is. And we can be rest assured that if there's any further bacteria that's floating around inside this pond, that the salt has more than likely taken care of it. And like I said, back to my office, I'm gonna go over all those details with you right next.
And now we have Epistilis. So again, going back to just doing some research online, Epistilis, let's just take a look at what Wikipedia has to say. And here's what it says: short oral disc and collar with a rigid stalk, often branching out to form a colony. And that's really a great way to describe it. Digging around looking for a really good picture, I came across this website here. And look at this poor guy right here. You can see it's so visible. Look at all these little guys here kind of standing up. And oftentimes what kills the fish isn't necessarily the Epistilis. It's actually a secondary infection. And I really love the fact that aquariumscience.org took a minute to basically point out that, hey, it is something that can oftentimes be confused with ick. Some people are going to think it's a bit of a fungus. And they go into details talking about what it looks like. It's translucent, gray and white. It sticks out into the water as opposed to ick, where it's flat against the fish. This has patchy coverage where ick is just pretty much the whole surface. Look further on down. Look at this poor baby right here. Look at that. Isn't that awful? But this is also columnaris with a secondary Epistilis infection. And the prognosis, I would say, looking at that fish, is fairly low. But again, these are common things that can happen in a fish pond. And just for whatever it's worth, the things that you're going to learn about this is that the number one common problem, that number one common cause that brings about this horrible thing for this fish is poor water quality. So if you're not taking care of your pond, this is unfortunately a resort, oftentimes a poor stewardship. Okay, so now we're going to talk about Kyla Danella. Kyla Danella, I'm going to tell you right now, this guy here is a murderer. If you have a pond that has Kyla Danella in it, you are in serious, serious trouble. I found a great website, and I happen to know Brian Fitzsimmons. He's the owner of Fitz's Fish Ponds. He's a really great guy, and he's out of New Jersey. Super knowledgeable, super great, super humble. And this is off of his website, and he's got a nice picture of what it's going to look like here. A little bit of a zoomed in shot, but basically he goes into some great details here. I highly recommend that you take some time to go into his website, take a look at what some of the signs and symptoms are. But then again, when you look at Kyla Danella, it absolutely clears easily with salt. And if you leave the salt in for 14 days, and you absolutely have to supplement with aeration, it's going to do really, really well with it. There's some really great articles on it. Some people are going to recommend a formalin treatment with, and those are all great, But again, the topic of this video really is salt. And since salt does so many great things to benefit the pond, I wanted you to be able to take a minute here and take a look at this. So look at, let's see what Fitz has to say. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, unfortunately, sadly, he's really not talking much about that. So pond owners can use formaldehyde or whatever this word is, methylene blue. And look, I'm not trying to disagree with Brian at all. Like I say, he's a fantastic guy, excellent fish keeper, runs an excellent business. These are all things that I would run to if salt doesn't work. But salt is absolutely going to be one of the very first lines of defense, at least with my customers with this. And like I say, do a little bit of research on your own. And here's an excellent website that goes into a little bit better detail on Kyla Danella. Okay, now if you want to see another bad boy that will kill your fish in huge numbers, and this is a bad one, and this is Castia. I came across this website, and really because I was looking for an excellent picture of a fish that was infected with Castia, and you can see yorkshirekoi.com.uk. Obviously, they're in the United Kingdom. And they have a great article here for you to download. And again, I'd like to point out these other websites that are out there just so that you can kind of see where some of these great resources. This is what I'm zooming in on right here. Look at this one right here. So if you look at this fish here, you can see that it's got all this stuff that's just coming out on its side. It's like milky, looks like kind of milky, kind of snotty. And here's what they say the symptoms are. Fish have become very lethargic. That's true. They stop feeding. They start hanging out in air columns. They have red areas, red scales, excess mucus. Yeah, that's snot I was talking about, showing classic Castia symptoms. Koi may present with sunken eyes and clamped fins. That's another thing. It's really interesting. Oftentimes you can look at fish and you can take a look at their behavior inside of a pond. And oftentimes just looking at the fish and their behavior is going to be enough to tell you that something is definitely wrong. So Castia, you can see it in a microscope at about 150 times power. It's going to look like little microscopic commas kind of floating around. At 400 power, it looks more like up here. And you can see how it attaches to the body. That's a really nasty guy. But again, salt is a tremendous, tremendous way to go to try to help fight this off. And it just doesn't like it. You're going to see this in the springtime, and that's usually when fish immunity is going to be compromised. And, you know, usually it dies pretty quickly with salt. And again, that's just a really great, that's good news because so far, we've gotten rid of Kyla Danella with salt. We've gotten rid of Castia with salt. And we're also going to get rid of Epistilis with salt. So just three of the most common things that you're going to find that are wrong with your pond fish are going to be taken care of with salt. And we're going to talk about some extra benefits of that as well. Here's a really great picture. Look at this. Under a microscope, doing a scrape and scope. Look at how they're just hanging off of the off of the scales of that particular fish. And I really love this article because they're doing something that a lot of people don't take the time to look at, is they don't take the time to look at the condition of the gills. This is the lungs of the fish. And people are afraid usually to do that. And again, they're going back to formalin or a malachite green kind of a treatment, which is okay. Potassium permanganate, oh my gosh. That is one of the strongest oxidizers that you can put into a pond. And if you do not know what you're doing with potassium permanganate, it's so much for your bio load. It is going to be destroyed. And also the malachite green and formalin is going to do the same thing to it. But potassium permanganate, that is the nuclear bomb. That is going to reset things all the way down to the beginning. Do I use it? Yes. There is a time, there is a place for it, and is it solid advice? Absolutely. But this video isn't for the people that have gotten all the way to the end of their rope and they can't figure out any other way. This video is for people, look, hey, let's take it easy. Let's start with salt. Salt is more than likely going to take care of this problem. It's going to go away. and one of the reasons, again, why you want to put salt into your pond. Okay, and finally, I want to bring you guys to my first reference, and I'm not kidding you. This is actually something I just saw for the first time right now. Doc Johnson, he's a doctor of veterinary medicine, and he wrote the Bible on koi health and disease. And I have the Koi Health and Disease volume number 2, and I read it all the time. And as you can see from his website, look, that's me, Columbia Water Gardens. Smart pond experts boned up on fish shells so they don't have to say, I don't know. And you know what's funny is this is a picture of me in my office sitting collapsed underneath this book, just being, oh my gosh, I cannot get enough. But I'm seeing this actually for the very first time. I love that picture, and I'm so excited to see it. But I'm a huge fan of Doc Johnson, and I love this book, and I would highly recommend that you would buy this for yourself. And I'm going to put a link on in this video so that you can go and you could buy this book for yourself. It's available all over the place, and you can get it through Amazon. You could buy it directly from Doc J, and I just love this. So if you're going to go and find this for yourself, look up drjohnson.com/the book. Let's see how easy it is to order. Let's take a look real quick here. I'm going to click on that. Come on. Oh, look at that. There it is. So Koi Health and Disease, Everything You Need to Know, second edition paperback, and you could buy it for $40. I'm going to tell you right now, this is the best $40 that you will ever spend on your experience with pond health. I cannot endorse this enough.